In his next letter, he wrote,
I don't know when I learned I would be king. It seems I've always known it. But two stories are told, and I've heard them so often they seem to be memories. One has me as a hero, the other is not so flattering. A lute was given to me when I was 6, and my sister Cecilia was 4. She coveted it and plucked at it whenever she could. Finally, I presented it to her, an act that signified to the servants that I would be a generous king. They never considered how indifferent a musician I was. My protestations that it was a small sacrifice to part with something I had little use for were taken as modesty, another fine kingly quality. However, I'm not sure how modesty figures in my retelling the tale to you. I do so because I want you to know I have qualities that others admire. What you will conclude from the next anecdote, I cannot guess. I was in the streets of Frel with my father when a man pelted him with an overripe tomato. While wiping at his clothes, my father spoke kindly to the man and ended by resolving his grievance. Afterward, I asked why the man hadn't been punished. When father told me I'd understand by the time I became king, I said I didn't want to be king if people threw tomatoes at me. I said it seemed a thankless task. Father roars with laughter when he tells this tale. Now I know why. It is a thankless task, but tomatoes are the least of it.
The conclusion I drew from this story was that Char wasn't above laughing at himself. Of course, he wasn't perfect. Eager to share his knowledge on any subject, he neglected to ascertain the interests of his listener, or, in my case, reader. He wrote more about Aortha than I ever wished to know. How the guilds were structured, the number of gallons of milk produced in a year by one Aorthian cow, the construction of their manors, and yet more. This was a minor flaw. He confessed a more serious one.
You are almost my sole confidant in this. The other is my horse, to whom I tell everything, because he can't condemn or offer advice. I write to you because you must know all. I trust you to find the good in me, but the bad I must be sure you don't overlook. I'm slow to anger, but also slow to forgive. For example, my language tutor had a way of making me feel a fool. I endured his abuse, but learned less than I might have if he'd been encouraging. Cecilia, who inherited his instruction after me, received the same treatment. The first time I found her crying, I warned him. The second time I dismissed him. Father trusted my judgment enough to let my actions stand. I went further. Boy as I was, I took measures to ensure the tutor would teach no more. But although my victory was complete and the man was ruined, and 6 years have passed, the thought of him still infuriates me. I'm angry now as I write these words. You may excuse me on the grounds of being a kind brother, which I hope I am. But I wonder at my rage. And I wonder too if my action against the tutor was at bottom a case of refusing, in another form, to let someone throw a tomato at me or my family.
In reply, I wrote, Mandy says there are two sorts of people in the world. Those who blame everyone else, and those who blame only themselves. I place myself in a third category, among those who know where the blame truly lies. You stand condemned. Your crime? Too much zeal in the protection of those you love. A fault and a virtue. Heinous. Although you've revealed your shortcomings to me, I feel compelled to no such frankness. You must discover my faults for yourself. And, although you've said it goes against the grain, you must find a way to forgive them. I remember the date of Char's next letter. Thursday, May 24th. He'd been gone half a year. Although the letter arrived in the morning, I was unable to read it all day. At dawn, I had to scrub the flagstones in our courtyard for Mum Olga. Then, Olive ordered me to count her coins in their thousands, repeatedly, because she kept thinking I had made a mistake. In the evening, Hattie had me help her prepare for a ball, including plucking out the hairs that grew in profusion above her upper lip. By the time Hattie departed, I was too late to help Mandy clean the kitchen. The rest of the night was mine, to use as I liked. In my room, I opened my little window and let the cool air wash over me. Then, I lit the bit of candle Mandy had smuggled to me, placing it carefully out of the breeze. I sat on my cot and opened my letter.
Dear Ella, impatience is not usually my weakness, but your letters torment me. They make me long to saddle my horse and ride to Frel, where I would make you explain yourself. They are playful, interesting, thoughtful, and occasionally serious. I'm overjoyed to receive them, yet they bring misery. You say little of your daily life. I have no idea how you occupy yourself. I don't mind. I enjoy guessing at the mystery. But what I really long to know, you do not tell either. What you feel, although I've given you hints by the score of my regard. You like me. You wouldn't waste time or paper on a being you didn't like. But I think I've loved you since we met at your mother's funeral. I want to be with you forever and beyond. But you write that you are too young to marry, or too old, or too short, or too hungry. Until I crumple your letters up in despair, only to smooth them out again for a 12th reading, hunting for hidden meanings. Father asks frequently in his letters whether I fancy any Aorthean young lady or any in our acquaintance at home. I say no. I suppose I'm confessing another fault. Pride. I don't want him to know that I love if my affections are not returned. You would charm him. And mother, too. They would be yours completely. As I am. What a wonderful bride you'll be. Whomever you marry, at whatever age. And what a queen if I am the man. Who has your grace? Your expression? Your voice? I could extol your virtues endlessly, but I want you to finish reading and answer me quickly. Today, I cannot write of Aortha or my doings or anything. I can only post this. And wait. Love. It is such a relief to pen the word. Love. Love. Char.